This is Encounter on VOA. Here's Carol Castillo.
Welcome to Encounter on the Voice of America. On this edition of the program, reaction to U.S. President Donald Trump's State of the Union address and the split between the U.S. intelligence community's assessment of national security threats and President Trump's. Hello again, I'm Carol Castiel. President Trump's State of the Union address last week largely focused on challenges at home, but it also touched on important foreign policy issues. President Trump has telegraphed for quite some time his strong interest in winding down seemingly endless conflicts and decreasing the U.S. military footprint overseas. To the dismay of many foreign policy establishment experts, as well as former Defense Secretary General Jim Mattis, who submitted his resignation last December, President Trump has vowed to bring American troops home from Syria. This despite the fact that ISIS, the so-called Islamic State, and Iran continue to pose a threat to U.S. interests.
When I took office, ISIS controlled more than 20,000 square miles in Iraq and Syria. Just 2 years ago. Today, we have liberated virtually all of the territory from the grip of these bloodthirsty monsters. Now, as we work with our allies to destroy the remnants of ISIS, it is time to give our brave warriors in Syria a warm welcome home.
However, the Republican-controlled Senate recently adopted an amendment to a broader Middle East policy bill that rebuked President Trump for what Republicans see as a precipitous withdrawal of troops from Syria and Afghanistan. Regarding Afghanistan, the United States has initiated peace talks with the enemy Taliban in a bid to wind down the U.S. troop presence. Here again is President Trump.
In Afghanistan, as we make progress in these negotiations, we will be able to reduce our troops' presence and focus on counterterrorism. We do not know whether we'll achieve an agreement, but we do know that after two decades of war, the hour has come to at least try for peace.
President Trump, in his address, also touted progress on North Korea, going so far as to say that America would likely be at war with Pyongyang if he had not won the presidency in 2016. And yet, there is still evidence that the North Koreans are committed to their nuclear program. In fact, in late January, senior U.S. intelligence officials warned of increased threats from tighter cooperation between China and Russia and differed with Mr. Trump in their analysis of North Korea, Syria, Iraq, and other hotspots. The leaders of the FBI, CIA, and the Director of National Intelligence told a Senate panel in late January that North Korea was unlikely to completely give up its nuclear weapons and production capabilities, that Iran is not trying to build a nuclear weapon, and that the so-called Islamic State, or Daesh, has not been defeated. On all these points, President Trump has asserted the contrary. Well, with us to comment on the State of the Union and analyze the splits between the U.S. foreign and intelligence community establishment and President Trump are two distinguished analysts. P.J. Crowley was former Assistant Secretary of State during the Obama administration, and he's the author of Red Line, American Foreign Policy in a Time of Fractured Politics and Failing States. He recently completed a fellowship at George Washington University. And Kim Holmes, he's the executive vice president of the Heritage Foundation. That's a conservative think tank here in Washington. He oversaw its defense and foreign policy team for more than two decades and served from 2002 to 2005 as Assistant Secretary of State for International Affairs during the George W. Bush administration. And Kim Holmes joins us by phone from the Heritage Foundation. Welcome to the program.
It's great to be with you, Carol. Thanks for having me.
Delighted to have you. And I'm delighted to welcome P.J. Crowley here in the studio.
Happy to be back.
Gentlemen, there's a lot to talk about in a very short period of time. Let me go first to P.J. Crowley about this disconnect that we heard between our intelligence chiefs and President Trump on major national security threats. He echoed some of that in the State of the Union address. What's your overall assessment of this disagreement and the implications thereof?
I'm not sure that I sensed a disagreement with the Trump administration policies, particularly as they pertain to, say, North Korea and the Islamic State. I did see where the intelligence chiefs seemed to throw cold water on some of the president's more optimistic or rosy expectations or statements. For example, last June, the president tweeted as he returned home from Singapore that the nuclear danger to the United States is over. And yet we see that, you know, 7 or 8 months later, there's been very little progress in terms of actual denuclearization. So yeah, I think that the fact that the intelligence chiefs are saying, you know, that there's no indication that Kim Jong-un is going to give up his nuclear weapons, that remains the challenge. It was the challenge for the Obama, Bush, and Clinton administrations before them. I mean, the president has put us in a more sustainable place. We're much better off than we were a year ago, for example. But I think contrary to perhaps to the president's expectations that this was going to be a rapid process, we now recognize that this is going to be a long, arduous negotiation.
Well, turning to you, Kim Holmes, for your overall assessment, not just on North Korea, but the contradictions between the U.S. intelligence chiefs and what Mr. Trump has been asserting, whether it's on Syria, North Korea, Iran, and ISIS.
Well, there is no secret, particularly between the Department of Defense and obviously some of the intelligence community, between what they want to see happen in Afghanistan, Syria, even with respect to al-Qaeda and ISIS, in terms of the military operations and what the president is trying to do with his bring the troops home strategy, both in Afghanistan and Syria. If you look at and read the actual report, and I got it here in front of me, there's not that much of a difference between the overall threat of what the president is saying and what the intelligence committee is saying. But what is happening here is the president is trying to accelerate the withdrawal of U.S. forces in these places. And that's predicated upon the assumption that we are actually winning in all of these areas. And that's not what the intelligence report is saying. Al-Qaeda and ISIS is still, even though they don't control a lot of territory or much territory in Iraq, they're still fine remnants and branches of them from Algeria all the way over to Indonesia. So they're still clearly operating. And the talks with the Taliban don't even involve the Afghan government, which is, I find, to be troubling. And also, many Republicans and conservatives, including me, had criticized President Barack Obama on his timetable approach to withdrawing forces from Iraq. And so we don't want to see that kind of strategy being implemented in these places, particularly with respect to Iraq and even Syria, when things were actually kind of moving in the right direction. So I just think that what we need to do is be more patient and hang in there and realize is that, you know, we're not going to be there forever in either Syria, Afghanistan, or any other places. But on the other hand, if you have a precipitous withdrawal, as we have seen in the past, very often these places can go back to hell in a handbasket very quick, and then we have to put our forces back into it.
Well, back to you, P.J. Crowley, and let me pick up on what Kim Holmes said, particularly with regard to the so-called Islamic State and Syria. President Trump criticized President Obama for withdrawing from Iraq precipitously, but it seems as if he may be engaging in the same behavior vis-a-vis Syria, even against the advice of his own military commanders. What do you think about his statement that somehow we have defeated ISIS, and the reality is the contrary, as articulated by intelligence chiefs, and the danger perhaps in precipitously removing U.S. troops from Syria? We even have Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, Republican Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, issuing a resolution against a precipitous withdrawal from troops from Syria. So this is an interesting disconnect.
I think you have a kind of an intellectual divide in one sense. The president communicates in through Twitter and crisp, sweeping statements that lack detail, nuance. That's how the president operates. Intelligence agencies live with nuance, detail. You know, their assessments are, we assess with high probability, modest confidence, whatever the case may be. So I think you have a situation here where the president is largely right about the military dimension of the immediate challenge of defeating the Islamic State caliphate. So in that narrow sense, the mission that the Obama administration created of defeating the Islamic State caliphate, and the Trump administration largely adopted. From a military standpoint, that mission is nearing completion. Now, we recognize that when you look at the challenge posed by the Islamic State or Al-Qaeda or other extremist groups, you know, what made the Islamic State unique was the fact that it occupied vast territories, the size of Indiana, for example. But even with the loss of territory, we're still going to be confronting the challenge of this ideology and the fact that between the Islamic State and Al-Qaeda, you still have global networks throughout the world. This is a generational challenge in terms of defeating those networks and defeating that ideology. The president's policy is reasonable. What is important now is the execution. A precipitous withdrawal from Syria risks a lot of things, adding to the influence of Russia, the conflict between the Kurds and the Turks. So his intent is reasonable. How we do this is going to be very, very important.
Well, back to you, Kim Holmes. Notwithstanding what P.J. Crowley just said, there still is a major disconnect because many analysts are concerned, as well as Republican and Democratic lawmakers, that those troops in Syria were performing an important task, notwithstanding the fact that the so-called caliphate, or the large part of the territory that ISIS occupied, has been defeated in a sense. So how do you see that? Because Mr. Trump also said that he wanted to move some troops to Iraq to so-called watch Iran, which is antagonizing our allies in Baghdad.
Well, a couple of things. One is that there were about 2,000 U.S. troops in Syria, and they were not really engaged in combat. They're support troops. And so it's not a terribly risky military operation in terms of the risks of lives for the United States, and such a low investment to try to keep the presence there so we don't completely withdraw and create a vacuum for Russia and Iran to come in and fill. It just seems to me that it's a relatively low cost to pay to avoid a very, very high cost strategic risk. But let's back up a little bit. You know, one thing about Donald Trump is it's never over until it's over, and even then it's not over. He launches all kinds of new narratives, both domestically and foreign policy, that start out in a certain direction, and 2 or 3 months later, it's all in a different direction. And this is where he is right now. About, in his mind, he's keeping the promise that he made in the campaign, he would end the wars and bring the troops home. He's on that. He was asking the Department of Defense for a plan for well over a year. He got very impatient when Secretary Mattis refused to give it to him, and this was partly a response to that impatience. But who knows? John Bolton doesn't like to pull out of places and give victories to our enemies. I know that for sure, and I don't think that anybody in the government wants to do that. And that's even true probably with Afghanistan. So I'm not so sure that even though right now that's where it seems to be, it seems like we've got the foot on the accelerator to get out, and I know that's what's been ordered in the Department of Defense. I've been told by my friends there that that's, in fact, what's happening. But I am just not 100% convinced that it's going to go on a direct line and be as quick as some people think.
We'll have more in just a moment, but first, you're listening to Encounter on The Voice of America. My guests are P.J. Crowley. He's former Assistant Secretary of State for Public Affairs and author of the book Red Line, American Foreign Policy in a Time of Fractured Politics and Failing States. And Kim Holmes. He's Executive Vice President at the Heritage Foundation, and that's a conservative think tank based here in Washington. And we're analyzing the unorthodox foreign policy under U.S. President Donald Trump and some differences between the U.S. intelligence community and his assessment of major national security threats. This is a reminder that our Encounter podcast is available on our website at voanews.com/encounter. You may also follow us on Twitter or connect with us on Facebook at Carol Castiel VOA. Well, here's a shout out to a loyal listener, Samuel Muzinguzi from Uganda. We extend our heartfelt condolences on the recent passing of his father. If you want to hear your name on the air, please send an email to encounter@voanews.com or like us and leave a comment on our Facebook page. Back to you, P.J. Crowley, to talk about Afghanistan. There seems to be perhaps a little more agreement on the need to start to withdraw troops. It's just a question of when and how. But Mr. Trump, by saying he'd like to withdraw troops, seems to be violating his own advice about telegraphing to the enemy, you know, about what one's intentions are. Nonetheless, how do you see Afghanistan going forward for the United States?
Well, there's a value in negotiation. This was an ambition of the Obama administration with Richard Holbrooke as the special representative for Afghanistan and Pakistan to try to get the Taliban into a formal negotiation. It didn't launch during the Obama administration. It has launched during the Trump administration. The challenge is to take the existing conversations and bring the Afghan government into that. The risk here is that we are delegitimizing what has been one of the United States's true achievements during our 18 years in Afghanistan, the creation of a central Afghan government. Obviously, it has challenges in terms of extending its writ of sovereignty across the entire country. So how we go about expanding this negotiation, bringing in the Afghan government, and then the details of what is finally agreed to, you know, will the Taliban, in fact, as has been the United States' demand for a long time, abide by the existing Afghan constitution, particularly the role of women in Afghan society? That's going to be critical. So, you know, the negotiations show some promise. I was surprised that the president, in his State of the Union address, you know, put real weight behind the Afghan negotiation and put some of his credibility behind the intent of the Taliban negotiators. But there's a lot of work yet to do. So this is wrapped up in a way that meets both American interests and American values.
But again, back to you, Kim Holmes, and again, back to this promise or prospect of U.S. troop withdrawal. That seems to be the real sticking point. And even as we said earlier, so many Republican lawmakers, Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, is arguing against a precipitous withdrawal of troops, particularly from Afghanistan. How do you see these splits between Mr. Trump, the intelligence chiefs, and many senior Republican lawmakers, especially with regard to Afghanistan, and the fact that the government there would like to see the troops stay for a while until the peace process gets on track and you don't have these sideshows in Moscow with other Taliban, you know, negotiators and non-Afghan government participants?
The concern that I think that a lot of Republicans in Congress have is that the Taliban is essentially negotiating mainly with the United States, signaling to us that they will, for the time being or under certain circumstances, rein in the violence and the fighting with the prospects of having some kind of a deal. The fact that it's not with the current government is confusing me because they're not really fully on board with what the United States is doing. But then once we pull out, then under those circumstances, as we have saw both in Afghanistan and other places like Vietnam, once the United States is gone, the war gets resumed. And then you have a total destruction of our friends and allies. That's the fear that a lot of us have in Afghanistan. We had this historical pattern in the United States of getting engaged militarily. It goes on way, way too long. I think it can be supported domestically by the political system. And then we start looking for quick ways out. And this is the concern that I have in Afghanistan.
Let's move on to another issue, P.J. Crowley, and that's another move that President Trump announced, that the United States is officially withdrawing from the Intermediate Range Nuclear Forces Treaty, or INF, because Russia has been violating that treaty. But analysts are saying the United States pulling out is not really the best answer, and that this could start another arms race. How do you see this, and are there dangers in this particular move on behalf of the United States to withdraw?
I mean, the broader context is a real downward spiral in the relationship between the United States and Russia. We have very serious tensions regarding what Russia has done in Syria, what Russia has done in Ukraine, what Russia has done in Georgia, other places. The fact that Russia attacked the United States for all intents and purposes with its interference in the 2016 campaign. There was for a long time an aspiration that perhaps arms control could be the one area where there could be continued cooperation. Obviously, you know, we've seen the mutual withdrawal of the United States and Russia from the INF. We're faced with the prospect of a New START treaty that will be expiring in a couple of years. So there is serious danger of an arms race. I look at the INF decision in much the same way as I look at the Iran nuclear deal. You know, INF treaty is dated in the respect that you don't have China and its growth of intermediate missiles as part of the treaty. Now the question is, are you better off negotiating within a treaty, or are you better off negotiating outside a treaty? and the Trump administration has moved in one direction. I would prefer that they continue to try to negotiate to get Russia back into compliance, you know, without a formal withdrawal, but this is where we are.
Well, how do you see it, Kim Holmes? Notwithstanding Russia's violations, do you think there might have been more constructive options? Some say that this sort of plays, that is, the United States withdrawing, plays into Russia's nefarious hands, in a sense, ceding ground to Russia and also antagonizing or worrying our European allies.
Well, I think the reason why Russia decided to develop and field this new ground-launched cruise missile that United States and also officially NATO determines is a violation of the INF Treaty is because Russia had decided that this treaty was constraining what they wanted to do. So Russia is the one getting out of the treaty. And if you think about it, they actually violate the treaty, they get out of the treaty, and actually develop material weaponry to get out of the treaty, and then maintain the fiction of being in the treaty as leverage over the United States to stay in and comply with their violations. It's completely got everything upside down in terms of logic of arms control. And so I don't think the president had any other choice. It's also, we should not be in a position where we're constraining ourselves with developing ballistic missiles or cruise missiles with respect to the threat from China, which is, frankly, probably a much bigger threat given the buildup of the Chinese. And so when you combine the price that we would have to pay to pretend to comply with the fact that actually the Russians have already gotten out of the treaty, it makes sense to me that they did what they did.
An interesting perspective. And as we close, back to you, P.J. Crowley. To wrap up here, where do you see U.S. foreign policy on these major issues going, given the tension and apparent disconnect between not just the U.S. intelligence community, but also members of Congress from the Republican Party and Mr. Trump? Why do you think this is occurring, and what are the implications going forward, whether on North Korea, on containing ISIS in Syria, on Iran?
Well, I think at the end of the day, details matter. I don't agree with everything in the Trump administration foreign policy. I think some of the things he's tried to do with respect to China and pushing back on its economic behavior, not playing by the rules, I think that's reasonable. My concerns remain the tools that the Trump administration prefers to use in pushing back on China, tariffs or a blunt instrument. I would have thought that the Trans-Pacific Partnership would be a better tool, unifying America's natural allies to isolate China economically, push them to abide by your rules and fair play. That would have been a better strategy. So I think the president is delivering the foreign policy that he advertised in 2016, but whether he's choosing the right tools and whether he has the right expectations about how hard this is, how long these challenges will take to solve, that to me is the greatest lesson from this recent exchange between the president and the intelligence chiefs. They're telling him the world is far more complex, these challenges are harder, and will take longer to solve, Mr. President, you think.
You get the last word, Kim Holmes, on where do you see foreign policy going?
Well, there's an ongoing, I don't know what to call it, maybe I can call it a negotiation between themes of President Donald Trump, what he likes to talk about, the way he sees America, and the actual details of policy that is not only something that's been sustained for decades, represented by the agencies and the traditions of the United States, and it's a back and forth between these two areas that you actually get the reality of what he does. On the one hand, he is saying something, I think, in foreign policy that's valuable to say. There are certain things in American foreign policy, and particularly with our relations, not only with our allies, but some of our adversaries, that do need to be reset. That, in fact, when he talks about America first, it's just a symbolic way of saying mainly to our allies, you need to be doing more for your own defense, and there's nothing wrong for us being concerned about our own national security and national interests. But at the same time, when you try to execute that policy in North Korea and China and Afghanistan, as we've been talking about here, the reality and the heaviness, if you will, of the world as it is starts conflicting with that vision that he has, and he tries to work out differences between them. That's what John Bolton is actually trying to navigate. Certainly, this is what Secretary Mattis was doing for years. It's an unfolding story, but we don't know exactly where it's going to go. But negotiating those two points of view is pretty much a lot about what foreign policy these days is about.
All right, gentlemen. Well, this isn't the first, and it won't be the last discussion on U.S. foreign policy under President Trump. But for now, I'm afraid that's all the time we have on this edition of Encounter. I'd like to thank my guests, P.J. Crowley, he's former Assistant Secretary of State, and Kim Holmes, also former Assistant Secretary of State. He's currently Executive Vice President of the Heritage Foundation. Gentlemen, a pleasure to have you. Thank you for your terrific insights.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Carol.
Encounter was produced in Washington. Thanks to Patrice Martin for booking our guests. Our engineer was Justin Thwaites. I'm Carol Castiel. Join me again next week for another Encounter on The Voice of America.